Please enter our time machine and prepare to journey back through time, with Rock and Roll Flashback Podcasts.
Thank you for that introduction, and welcome to Rock and Roll Flashback. I'm Jumpin John, and we'll be looking back at some of rock and roll's greatest artists, songs, and stories. In this episode, I will discuss the American folk rock band called the Lovin Spoonful. The Lovin Spoonful were among the first American groups to challenge the domination of the British invasion bands in the mid-1960s. Between 1965 and 1967, the group was astonishingly successful, issuing one hit single after another. So please settle back and daydream along with me as we flash back to the 1960s in New York City's Greenwich Village. John Sebastian was the son of a classical harmonica player. John is proficient on guitar, harmonica, piano, and the auto harp. Growing up in Greenwich Village, Sebastian played in rock bands as a teenager. Beginning in the early 1960s, he worked as a studio musician. In 1964, Eric Jacobson, the former banjo player of the bluegrass band Knob Lick Upper 10,000, moved into the apartment next door to John Sebastian. The two soon bonded, and Jacobson would eventually act as producer for the Lovin Spoonful. After initially performing in the Halifax Three, Canadian-born guitarist Zal Yanovsky was also active in Greenwich Village's folk music scene. John Sebastian and Zal Yanovsky met on February 9, 1964, at the apartment of Cass Elliott. Yanovsky had been recruited by Elliott to join her New York City group, the Mugwumps. Sebastian had briefly played with the Even Dozen Jug Band before he was also recruited into the Mugwumps to play harmonica. During live performances with the Mugwumps, Yanovsky and Sebastian often improvised off of one another on guitar and harmonica. After the Mugwumps dissolved in late 1964, Sebastian and Yanovsky began planning to form their own electric jug band group. Sebastian and Yanovsky contacted Bob Cavallo, the former manager of the Halifax Three and the Mugwumps. Cavallo agreed to manage Sebastian and Yanovsky's group even though they had not performed publicly, had no songs, and had no band name. Sebastian would contribute guitar, harmonica, auto harp, and vocals, and Yanovsky would handle guitar and backing vocals. They recruited Steve Boone on bass and, initially, Jan Carl on drums. Carl was the manager of the Bull's Head Inn, where the band rehearsed for several weeks in December 1964 and January 1965. Fritz Richmond, the washtub bass player for Jim Queskin and the Jug Band, suggested to Sebastian the name The Lovin' Spoonful. It was a reference to the lyrics of the song Coffee Blues by the country blues musician Mississippi John Hurt. Sebastian and Yanovsky liked the suggestion, and it became the band's name. In January, the band fired their first drummer. Having fired Carl, the Lovin Spoonful could no longer practice at the Bull's Head and were in need of a new rehearsal space. The band had little money and had been living with Cass Elliott in her village apartment at the Hotel Albert. They rehearsed at the Hotel Albert, where they auditioned Joe Butler on drums. In January 1965, the band hired Butler on drums. The band made their first live performance in late January 1965 at Greenwich Village's Night Owl Cafe, holding a two-week residency. While waiting to be signed to a record label, the Lovin Spoonful also performed at Greenwich Village's Cafe Wa. They also played several sets a night for 6 days a week at Cafe Bazaar on McDougal Street in Greenwich Village. In May 1965, the band returned to performing at the Night Owl. It was there that John Sebastian wrote a new song, Do You Believe in Magic? The song was reportedly about the transformative power of music. Sebastian was inspired by a woman getting up and dancing while the band played a June 1965 gig at the Folk Music Club at 48 in Cambridge, Massachusetts. The term folk rock was coined in the June 12, 1965 issue of Billboard magazine by Elliot Siegel. He used the term principally to describe the music of the Byrds. Even though the group had not yet released a record, Siegel also mentioned the Lovin Spoonful as an act working in the New York area with a folk rock sound. The Lovin Spoonful hoped to record a demo of the song Do You Believe in Magic, but couldn't afford a recording session. Eric Jacobson fronted a June 1965 session with his own money at Bell Sound Studios in New York. There, the band recorded Do You Believe in Magic and several other songs. Jacobson invited Jerry Yester to participate in the session, adding both piano and backing vocals, and session musician Gary Chester played tambourine. Jacobson and Cavallo took an acetate disc of the demo to numerous record labels, but no one was interested in signing the band. After attending one of the Lovin Spoonful's performances at the Night Owl, producer Phil Spector listened to the acetate and briefly considered signing the band to his label, Phillies Records. Spector passed on the band. Then Elektra Records approached the Lovin Spoonful. A monetary disagreement delayed a signing with Elektra. The band ended up signing with Koppelman Rubin, an entertainment company. In turn, that company signed them to Kama Sutra Records in June 1965. As part of the deal, MGM Records distributed the records which Kama Sutra released for Koppelman Rubin. The arrangement's format of multiple middlemen left little in profits for the band. Sebastian later said that not signing with Elektra was, and I quote, the worst decision I ever made in my life, end quote. Kama Sutra saw no need to re-record Jacobson's original demo of Do You Believe in Magic. They issued the demo version on July 20th, 1965. It debuted on the Billboard Hot 100 a month later, remaining on the chart for 13 weeks and peaking in October at number 9. Beginning in August 1965, the band toured the U.S. West Coast. They appeared in San Francisco at several clubs on Los Angeles's Sunset Strip and performed in front of 35,000 at the Rose Bowl in Pasadena, California, as one of the support acts for Herman's Hermits. The band recorded 13 songs between June and September 1965 at both Bell Sound in New York and at RCA Studios in Hollywood. These songs became their debut album, Do You Believe in Magic? Kama Sutra issued the album in November 1965. It debuted on the Billboard Top LPs chart on December 4th and was on the chart for 19 weeks, peaking in February 1966 at number 71. By late 1965, the Lovin Spoonful had appeared on several U.S. TV shows, including Where the Action Is, Shindig, and Hullabaloo. Executives from NBC approached Cavallo to offer the band the opportunity to star in their own television series to be called The Monkees. The Lovin Spoonful was the only existing group considered for the show, however, they declined the offer. In November 1965, the Lovin Spoonful toured with the Supremes. They performed at colleges across the southern U.S., traveling by bus and partying together. Sebastian composed the song Daydream while riding on the tour bus. After that tour, the Lovin Spoonful went to Los Angeles. They appeared in the concert film The Big TNT Show. The band remained in L.A. to do several weeks of a residency at the Trip nightclub on Sunset Boulevard. Then back in New York City from December 13th to 16th, the band recorded most of their second album, Daydream, at Bell Sound Studios. Some songs for the album were recorded in November, including You Didn't Have to Be So Nice. Additional sessions took place at Columbia Studios in New York City and RCA Studios in Hollywood, California. Kama Sutra had issued You Didn't Have to Be So Nice as a single on November 13th, and it peaked at number 10 on the Billboard Hot 100 in January 1966. The Daydream sessions had come 10 weeks after the band finished their first album, and the band had had little time to rehearse new material. While Do You Believe in Magic contained 5 original compositions, 11 out of 12 tracks on Daydream were original. Kama Sutra released the album in March 1966, and it reached number 10 on the Billboard Top LPs chart. It was the band's best performing studio album. Kama Sutra issued the Daydream single in February 1966. Daydream remained on the Hot 100 for 12 weeks, peaking at number 2 for 2 weeks in mid-April. The single reached number 1 on Cashbox Magazine's chart and also reached number 1 in Canada. Due to the success of Daydream, the Lovin Spoonful could now headline their concerts rather than perform as a support act. When the band toured with the Beach Boys in March and April 1966, the two groups alternated top billing. The band was approached to provide a soundtrack for What's Up, Tiger Lily, the directorial debut of the comedian Woody Allen, who knew the band from his work at clubs in Greenwich Village. The band recorded the soundtrack on April 11th and 12th at National Recording Studios in New York City, and they made a brief appearance in the film. Issued in August 1966, the movie soundtrack album only reached number 126 on the Billboard LPs chart. Though the Lovin Spoonful had achieved quick success in North America, none of their singles had charted in the UK. To expand the band's popularity to an international audience, their management organized several live and TV dates in England and Sweden in April 1966. On April 12th, the band arrived in London to begin their 10-day tour of England and Sweden. The band's time in England allowed them to interact with many of Britain's top musicians. Daydream became a major international hit. By mid-May, it had reached number 2 on all the major British singles charts and number 1 in Sweden. The Lovin Spoonful played on their own recordings and were against the use of studio musicians. The band sought to avoid being typecast and aimed to sound different with each single. As part of their efforts, the band incorporated a variety of instruments on their recordings, including a bass marimba, chimes, an Irish harp, and a Hohner Tubon. They also used resonator, pedal steel, and open-tuned 12-string guitars. The band's music prominently featured the auto harp. Sebastian would amplify his auto harp by taping a ukulele contact microphone onto the back of it and then plugging it into an amp. After recording 2 albums in the second half of 1965, the Lovin Spoonful needed new material. John Sebastian took a song composed by his younger brother Mark. Sebastian then reworked the lyrics and melody of his brother's composition into Summer in the City. The Lovin Spoonful recorded Summer in the City in March 1966 at Columbia Records' 7th Avenue studio in New York City. It took two sessions to complete the song. During the first, they recorded the instrumental track in four steps, beginning with drums and organ, electric piano, and rhythm guitar. Session musician Artie Schrock played the Wurlitzer electric piano part, Boone overdubbed his bass, Sebastian played auto harp, and Yanovsky layered in guitar. The last instrumental overdub included added extra percussion. A microphone was hung inside a garbage can, and Yanovsky hit the side of the can with a drumstick. John Sebastian sang his lead vocal the next night with Zal Yanovsky and Joe Butler contributing backing vocals. To increase the amount of reverb on the track, recording engineer Roy Halley placed a microphone on the eighth floor of a metal staircase and a large speaker on the ground floor. During the sessions, the band suggested to producer Jacobson that they add city noises to the track. They decided on the sound of car horns and a pneumatic drill. The effects were among the first on a pop song to employ an overlapping crossfade, an effect that had typically only been used on comedy albums. Mixing for Summer in the City concluded after the Lovin Spoonful returned from Europe in May 1966. Kama Sutra did not issue Summer in the City immediately. Instead, they released Did You Ever Have to Make Up Your Mind as a single. Did You Ever Have to Make Up Your Mind reached number two on the Billboard Hot 100 in June 1966, making it the band's fourth top 10 single in the U.S. and their second top two record in a row. That same month, Do You Believe in Magic re-entered the top LPs chart, peaking in August at number 32 after spending 16 more weeks on the chart. Kama Sutra Records finally released Summer in the City as a single on July 4, 1966. Summer in the City was the Lovin' Spoonful's fifth single and one of six released between December 1965 and December 1966 that reached the top 10 in the U.S. The single rose quickly, and on August 13th, it became the Lovin' Spoonful's first and only number one single in the U.S. It held the position for 3 weeks. In addition to reaching number one on Billboard, it hit number one on Cashbox, on Record World's Top 100 charts, and in Canada. Expectations were high for Summer in the City in the U.K., but the song failed to enter the top five and only peaked at number eight in the U.K. Another U.K. tour planned for October 1966 was postponed until April 1967. In July 1966, the Lovin' Spoonful played to a crowd of 65,000 at that year's Newport Folk Festival in Rhode Island. The Lovin' Spoonful's image was influential on their contemporaries. The band's stage act was both eccentric and extroverted, driven by Yanovsky and his colorful wardrobe. The American men's fashion magazine Esquire produced a fashion spread of the band in its June 1966 issue, detailing how the band sported mod gear from New York's 7th Avenue. In 1966, the Lovin' Spoonful were one of the most popular American bands. However, the band's popularity took a big hit when it became known that Boone and Yanovsky had been arrested in San Francisco for possessing marijuana on May 20, 1966. Yanovsky was a Canadian citizen. Threatened with deportation, Zal ratted out the dealer's name to police. In exchange, all charges were dropped, their arrest records were expunged, the two did not need to appear in court, and there was no immediate publicity related to their arrest. However, after the drug case went to court in December 1966, knowledge of Yanovsky's and Boone's bust became more widespread. There was a fan backlash, and the underground press was especially critical of the band. By early 1967, the Lovin' Spoonful shows on the West Coast were sometimes picketed by members of the 60s counterculture. The public revelations of the drug added to the internal tension already created by the diverging interests of the band members. Sessions for the Lovin' Spoonful's third studio album, later released as Hums of the Lovin' Spoonful, was recorded across several sessions in New York City and L.A. Henry Diltz, famous photographer and a member of the Modern Folk Quartet, contributed clarinet to the song Best Friends. Diltz also took the pictures for the LP's sleeve. The Hums album was released in November 1966, spent 6 months on the Billboard's LP chart, and peaked at number 14. Their sixth consecutive top 10 hit, Rain on the Roof, reached number 10 on the Billboard Hot 100. It was followed by their seventh top 10 hit, Nashville Cats, which reached number 8. In mid-October 1966, the Lovin Spoonful had recorded a soundtrack album for You're a Big Boy Now. The film was the master's thesis for a young director, Francis Ford Coppola, at the UCLA Film School. This resulted in their next single, Darling Be Home Soon. Darling Be Home Soon only peaked at number 15. Also disappointing was the release of the You're a Big Boy Now soundtrack, which only peaked at number 160 on the Billboard Top LPs chart in May 1967. The album's sales were hampered by the release in March 1967 of the band's first greatest hits compilation, The Best of the Lovin Spoonful, which reached number 3 and became the band's best-selling album. In 1966, the Lovin Spoonful had 5 top 10 singles, making it the band's most successful year to date. Billboard magazine's year-end issue ranked the Lovin Spoonful as the third best-performing singles artist of the year, after the Beatles and the Rolling Stones. In the Billboard's list of the top records of the year, it placed Summer in the City, Daydream, and Did You Ever Have to Make Up Your Mind at numbers 35, 38, and 48, respectively. From late 1966 into early 1967, tensions persisted within the Lovin Spoonful. John Sebastian's bandmates felt he was exerting excessive control over the band's direction. Koppelman and Rubin renegotiated the band's distribution deal between Kama Sutra and MGM in late 1966. Kama Sutra added a key man clause, which specified that the band would only exist if Sebastian was a member. Due to disagreements over their artistic direction, the band eventually fired Yanofsky in May 1967, replacing him with Jerry Yester. Yester had appeared on some of the band's recording sessions and was the former producer of The Association. After Yanofsky left, the band's musical style changed, becoming less eclectic and more pop-oriented. Also, the Lovin Spoonful struggled to transition their approach as psychedelia expanded in popularity in 1967. The new band lineup began their sessions for the next album, Everything Playing, in August at the Mira Sound Studios in New York City. Mira Sound had just installed the Ampex MM-1000, the industry's first 16-track recorder. The band struggled to manage Mira Sound's complicated recording equipment, and the 3 singles from the Everything Today sessions all failed to place in a top 10. After the commercial disappointments of Everything Playing, Sebastian announced that following the band's next 3 months of scheduled tour dates, he planned to leave the group. After leaving the Lovin Spoonful, John Sebastian remained active in the concert and festival circuit. In August 1969, Sebastian traveled to the Woodstock Music and Art Fair. Attending the festival as a spectator, Sebastian was asked to do an impromptu appearance when the organizers suddenly needed a performer to fill in time. Sebastian's performance ended up on the original Woodstock album and in the documentary film. After John Sebastian's first 5 singles were commercial failures, Reprise Records planned to drop him. In 1976, he surprisingly achieved a number 1 hit with his song Welcome Back, the theme song for the TV show Welcome Back, Kotter. However, he was unable to translate it into continued success. In addition to releasing a few uneventful albums, Sebastian was a frequent contributor to film and TV soundtracks. During the 1960s and 1970s, Sebastian guested on a number of recordings by other artists. His role as session musician usually had him playing harmonica, as in the Doors' song Roadhouse Blues, Gordon Lightfoot's The Pony Man, and Crosby, Stills, Nash & Young's song Deja Vu. Interestingly, Sebastian had previously been asked by Crosby, Stills, and Nash to join their group as a fourth member, but turned them down. John Sebastian resisted subsequent efforts to reform the Lovin Spoonful, and the original members of the band only reunited twice, in late 1979 at the invitation of the musician Paul Simon. The band appeared in his 1980 film One Trick Pony. Then in 2000, the Lovin Spoonful was inducted into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame in Cleveland. At the induction, Sebastian, Yanofsky, Boone, and Butler performed together for the last time. Sadly, Yanofsky died of a heart attack 2 years later. This has been Rock and Roll Flashback. A look at the career of the Lovin Spoonful. The band was among the most popular groups in the U.S. for a short period in the mid-1960s, and their music and image influenced many of the contemporary rock acts of their era. Beginning in July 1965 with their debut single, Do You Believe in Magic?, the Lovin Spoonful had 7 consecutive singles reach the top 10 of the U.S. charts in the 18 months that followed. I'm Jumpin' John McDermott, and until next time...
Rock on, rock on, rock on, rock on, rock on, rock on.
Hot town, summer in the city, back of my neck getting dirt and gritty. Bend down, isn't it a pity, doesn't seem to be a shadow in the city. All around, people looking half dead, walking on the sidewalk harder than a match here. But at night, it's a different world. Go out and find a girl. Come on and dance all night. Despite the heat, it'll be alright. And babe, don't you know it's a pity the days can't be like the nights in the summer, in the city, in the summer, in the city. Cool town, meeting in the city, dressed so fine and looking so pretty. Cool cat, looking for a kitty, gonna look in every corner of the city. Till I'm wheezing like a bus stop, running up the stairs, gonna meet you on the rooftop. But at night it's a different world. Go out and find a girl. Come on and dance all night. Despite the heat, it'll be alright. And babe, don't you know it's a pity the days can't be like the nights in the summer, in the city, in the summer, in the city. Summer in the city, summer in the city.